the coldest hearts. Lonely people are somewhere. Lonely people cast away for the crimes they committed and the loved ones they pain. Hope for redemption on a crowded train. Can you spare some change? Cause my baby needs some diapers.
What's good, everybody? What's good? Welcome back to yet another episode of Off the Strength, where we're giving you the inside look into all things wellness culture. I'm a trainer called Tony, and of course, with me, I got some gentlemen of extraordinary league. Guys, let's go around the table and introduce ourselves, please.
K.R. Jones is in the building. Good morning.
You're a trainer, Corey, feeling so soulful.
Right? You know, you got to come in with that Subway art. It give you something special. You know, lonely people, they say, are Subway art. That's Tish Hammond over there, you know. And I felt a certain kind of way. I was feeling soulful, you know. We had to have the grace of some very special company today, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls from near and far. All right, it's too many of y'all for me to intro just going down the line. So we're going to kick this off like this. Now, I've talked about this woman very specifically multiple times because she is randomly offensive from time to time. I'm not even going to tell them about the joke that you made.
It's strategically
when I was in a time of need. She was roasting me, but I appreciate the fact that she kept that same energy. What's going on? She's laughing still. She's laughing at my pain, y'all. I want you to introduce yourself, please.
What's up, everyone? I'm Just Latasha. How y'all doing?
Hey, Just Latasha. All right, let's make some noise for Just Latasha.
Thank you.
Keep that thing loaded. She ready to roast. Don't matter. She's ready to go for it. Okay. And we have some more esteemed guests. Please go ahead and introduce yourself.
It's me, Good Looking Lee from the Thank We Later podcast.
And you know her co-host is here with her. Hey, Noelle K.
Oh, damn. We got a pod extravaganza setting up in here.
It's a whole lot of pod.
Stuff is happening. What's going on, y'all? How y'all feeling today?
I'm feeling amazing. Today is an amazing day.
There we go.
Seriously, I actually do feel that way. The sun and the fall weather setting in.
You know, it's 11:11, so... Hey.
Yeah.
See, look, you already just hit me with some science I wasn't even ready for. It's 11:11. It's like, what? Look at that.
Is that a thing? Does that mean something?
11:11 is a thing. It's supposed to be like the portal for manifestation, like the most powerful moment to manifest.
Third eyes open. Hella open.
So I tell you every 11:11 on the time you make a wish, you know, just kind of bring things into existence that you want and need.
That's what's up.
That's what's up. I don't
new
know.
Knowledge,
if
it, new knowledge. Wasn't aware.
Yeah. I don't know if it's going to drop on 11:11. So by the time you hear this, I hope you already
you missed
made
your shot. You missed your damn
shot. We're past it. We missed the moment.
Rewind.
Better wait on 12:12 and see what you can do.
Yeah. Note for next year. Make a note to self.
See if you can renege on the 12:12 and throw something back. I'll put something on it for next year.
Yeah. You know, something like that. You know, Brother Jones, did you have any mysticism on this 11:11, man? Because you know he's a spiritual advisor of this space.
He ain't advised me about this damn 11:11.
Tell me shit about it. That's why I feel like I'm out here.
Y'all don't be listening when I be talking. You know what I'm saying?
Day's not over yet.
You don't be talking when I'm listening.
I guess. I definitely feel like I knew something about it. Nothing too crazy, though. Remember in Us, wasn't that the movie? When it was that 11:11 too? The little...
Yeah.
But that was completely different. But yeah.
And it's in The Joker as well. In the new movie, The Joker. And yeah. The time... I don't want to give it away if anybody didn't see the movie. But
we ain't going to go see it.
They do.
Everybody who wanted to see it, they don't see it.
They probably saw it.
Everyone who missed it, it was a decision.
With 11:11 on in the movie.
That's what's up. So I need to set my clock. I need to be intent, and I need to have my third eye open for today is what y'all saying. Well, it's great to have some awesome creatives inside this space when we're in this, you know, dawning of the age of whatever month we're in. I don't know anything about the esoteric sciences, so y'all can correct my ignorance all the way through there. But I'm happy to have some creative folks that I genuinely like and support. So the way that we got to kick this thing off is we like to talk about this whole wellness thing and this whole health space, right? But I want to have a healthy dialogue today, especially with people who are constantly conversing, going back and forth. I want to hear the good. I want to hear the bad. I want to hear everything that's in between. But first, I need to understand, where were y'all when y'all first fell in love with this thing that we call podcasting? We're going to flip it up a little bit like that, or creating in any certain space. So Good Looking Lee, I see you look like you had something on your mind. I saw you sit back. It was like, I know. Yeah. All right, we're going to get up in here.
Because I remember, I never forget, right? So I had moved out to London. I had creative blocks. So I moved and I was like, you know, I got to figure something out. I was a photographer at the time. And everybody always told me, like, yo, you should do TV and radio. And I'm like, nah, I can't do that. I get kicked out of class too much. So I'm like, yo, one day, I don't know why, I just started listening to, like, Tax Season. Then I got into what's Queen's Flip Show? His show, I think it's like Flip the Script, and the Joe Budden Show. I'm listening. I come back to New York. I say, you know what? I'm going to do it. I was just listening. I'm like, I don't know. For some reason, I was like, you know what? People want to hear me speak. Nobody ever said that except for you should do TV and radio. I say, you know what? I'm going to do it. So I came. I had an ad out on Craigslist. I was working with a web series. And I always tell people, don't do what I did, but this studio hit me up. Like, yo, you want to do a tour of the studio? And I was like, yeah, this is amazing. I can't wait. Went. Nobody with me, by myself. We was in like a little closet.
Yeah.
I was like, yo, I'm going to do this.
You talking about OG GPS days.
Yeah, OG. Like, I'm talking about before we was by the World Trade.
Yeah.
The lights was flickering. Like, if you went to the bathroom at a certain time, you had to go with the light on your phone.
Yeah.
Stuff like that. You
I'd
know
have walked
saying?
Out. I'm going
to be straight yeah. up. Yeah,
I
definitely.
I need to see my penis well.
You know what I'm saying?
I need to see the whole
thing. You know what I'm saying?
I need to see the whole
but
thing.
But it wasn't even just that. I went and met two people off of Craigslist. I didn't bring nobody with me.
Also,
you know what I'm
wild.
Saying? And they both, they white, and they taller than me. So I was just like, this is amazing. And I went and but I remember sitting in a stock room in Soho at Clark's, and I was like, yo, I could do this. I was like, yo, I really could do this. And then I think probably like 2 weeks later, I did three shows back to back to back in one day. And it's been that, for real.
That's what's up. And let people know where we know you from, for sure, because by the time this drops, there's definitely going to be an episode posted up on our side letting them know. When I was rudely interrupted again.
Oh, thanks, thanks. Adjectives we choose.
Yeah. You know, I started Thank Me Later going on 2 years ago.
That's what's up.
Thank Me Later, yeah. And, you know, it's crazy. The other day I checked, finally owned my trademark. So
there we go.
Mine, yeah.
You locked it up across all the
boards. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
All right,
so
there we go.
I was super happy about that. But I just remember 2 years ago, I didn't know what to do with myself. And iHeartRadio had told me you needed 25 years of experience for the job I wanted.
Sure.
I was like, yo, I'm 25. So there's that. I was like, there's that.
25 years.
Did you start in utero?
Yeah.
That's what we
you know,
know
what I'm saying?
Like, what you applying for, CEO? Yeah.
Nah, I was just trying to be in front of the camera.
Yo, I want to run all of this. Like, yo, we need 25.
You know what I'm saying? And then I was like, yo, I'm going to do it myself. And now, you know, Thank Me Later's on iHeart. So now they work for me.
Hey, look at that. Hey.
How that works?
Yeah. Salute.
Yeah, but the last 2 years, I was just like, but it, like every time I record, you just fall more in love. You fall more in love. I don't think it's something that stops.
There we go. I love that. I love that. All right, Noelle, I'm going to look at you over here.
Okay,
right? Now, you know how I personally feel about you. If you're going to get on this microphone and don't give me no bars. It's going to sound real nervous.
Maybe I'll serenade y'all later.
That's
me a question.
Love,
like,
it's love.
I asked
you,
you a question.
To answer in song. Like,
yeah,
okay.
Exactly. That's what I was about to say. You know, we need to.
I learned about the podcast.
We're not doing
on the podcast.
Nah. The irony of that, though, a year ago today, I did my first interview with Thank Me Later as a guest. I came on because I'm a singer-songwriter from the Bronx. And
we won't hold it against you here.
Right. I was just about
listen,
to
listen, I always got to name my city because y'all got to be. Y'all was trying to come from my city.
BK all day. That's all I got to say on that.
BX all day. I'm sorry. Y'all don't even get the K on the bus. Like, y'all just get the B.
Disrespect.
A year ago today, though, I did come on Thank Me Later podcast as a guest for the first time. And what I thought was just an interview turned into me being a co-host on the show a few months later. So Lee saw my falling in love with podcasting before I did. So that was amazing to watch and her see something in me that I didn't necessarily see in myself. But people also have told me like, oh my gosh, I love your voice. Like, you should do radio too, even though I sing. It's like, listen to my music. Like, what you mean I should do radio? I'm trying to get these vocals out. But it's been an amazing journey with her.
I love that. Yeah. I love that. Okay, and last, and you know.
Go ahead. Get it. Just get it out, Tony. Get it out. Say what you want to say.
Nah, I don't know if you want to open the door and start in the dark, because you know she's going to get you.
But that's why I got to get a head start. I feel like
last
I'm already.
Time, I had to hug Decent last time I saw that man.
Yeah, you know, shout out to Decent, man.
Listen, I can't get got by somebody before lenses. So let me tell you guys.
I knew it.
Let me tell you guys a little something about.
Focused. Yeah, exactly. I need to be able to put these down if I had to start crying.
His third and fourth eye are looking at you right now.
It's 11-11. I have full shape. That's what he's ready for.
Heard you.
They doubling up, so I doubled
doubling
up. You know?
Yeah,
you know?
Look at that. Look at that. He was already present.
You ain't ready for the visionary. You ain't ready for the vision.
Twice
no,
as ready.
I'm not. I'm not. coming on 2020, this will be a 10-year journey for me. I started in 2010 doing interviews on the street because I was looking around like at talent and fashion and music, and I was like, how come we don't have nothing to like promote ourselves? Like, you either got to be hot and mainstream before people start giving a fuck about what you do. And I was like, I should just be that platform then. What am I waiting for? So I went to Best Buy, bought a camera, bought a mic, and I just started going on the street and asking people originally like about their style before I started talking to a music artist. And I just, that's been my intention since I started, is to uplift underground Black creatives and really being intentional about who we support, who we celebrate, and having that pride in who we are. And that has manifested in so many other ways. I did a web series. I have a YouTube vlog. I have a comedy talk show called We Shall Over Chug. Shout out to my boy Jameer Pond and Decent of Pop Dust. And
yes, my boy too. Hey.
All right.
Hey, Dwayne,
right.
I'm with all his government.
Oh, you did
wow.
that.
Why you got- She did that.
He loved his name. We all love his name. It don't mean that you gotta.
She got on Nike.
Find her. Get out there.
Yeah. Wow. And then I think the turning point for me at this point has been joining the Grapevine TV. I had a huge audience wanting to listen to my opinions on social issues, and I'd already been talking about racism, but in a comedic way on YouTube. And but going on the Grapevine was really, people are coming to me to hear, like, to set things right, and like really give out that harsh opinion that we may need sometimes. So
I love
it's been super
show.
Dope. Me too, girl.
I love it.
Hell yeah. For sure. And I do give her a hard time, but I am seriously, I'd say, proud of all the accomplishments that I've been aware of just in the short amount of time. I haven't known you for a long time, so I ain't gonna act like we go way back and that like that. But, you know, and that's why I still gotta keep that boundary, you know. It's like, all right, new friend, let's right. take it easy.
Right. But yeah,
I like
Tony.
Yeah.
I feel like I miss so much, you know
yeah.
what I'm saying? Like,
nah, there's episodes. This
what
is
he's
like
not saying is he stalked me all summer.
Nah.
Wherever I was, I looked 10 feet behind me and Tony in the corner.
Even,
and yo, acting
he
like,
been
oh,
stalking
we just
her
ran
even
into
if he get
other.
There first.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I was about to say.
He was never there first, ever. He's never there first.
It's because I was trying to get into the creative spaces, and I see somebody who is, again, admirable in these creative spaces. A self-starter, an entrepreneur, somebody who's doing a multi-hyphenated person of a specific genre. I want to be in those rooms, and I want to understand, and I want to be ignorant in those rooms because it's a chance to learn in the best way, shape, or form. And I do appreciate everything that I've been able to understand in those rooms, even if I wasn't invited by, you know, current
See?
Company.
Yeah, I heard that,
you know?
Right?
I appreciate the opportunity
the
to be in those spaces, you
you're
know?
Don't look this way, but I will give it to you that right? you do that, because when you came to the live show, that was amazing to see that you were literally the only man in the room. Well, besides Matt.
Yeah.
Matt counts, technically.
Matt I was about to say.
But
he might not have been
in the room.
Oh,
okay. He actually was in the back, so I just wanted to say that.
I was in a space where it was like, yo,
yes.
it could be nervous. Listen, this
yes.
is women hear me more roar. I was like, yo, I'm an ally. I'm walking
right.
in as an ally.
You
I want to support
you
everybody
did.
On the other side. So that's the... That was your first live show.
Yes.
And I wanted to be over there because, again, we've been going back and forth on email. But if I say something, I'm going to show up. It's mm-hmm. like, yo, this is where I'm at. All right. And I'm hearing, I heard a lot of like, yeah, men need to do this. Men need to do that. I was like, all right. Yo, I'm still here, y'all.
Yeah, looking in the crowd. I was like, wait.
Tony got
the
notebook out.
Here, though,
yeah.
He was in the corner like you said.
I was in the corner just chilling.
He just
he be in there. You just,
you know a lot of sat up front.
Else first. You meet directly with his right. eyes first. It's so intense.
Because I'm trying to understand.
Which set were you looking at? The top set or the bottom set? Which,
yeah, exactly.
Which set of eyes was I looking at?
Because if you're looking at 3 and 4, they're going to get you.
Right.
You
wear those glasses often, I'm assuming.
I mean, Dwayne
just
was an icon, you know?
Mainly just to see.
You know? Just
when he needs to see shit.
Yeah, you know?
It's a different world.
See? I knew she was going to get to it. See?
That's the only one, though.
I like it, you know? It brings it
you.
In, you know? And we are in a different world. See, where you going on that? We are in a totally different space with this whole creative process, and I see a lot of different green ways to try to move everything forward. We're lifting culture. We're changing. We're trying to do our best to make this whole wellness thing a lot more accessible, and I love the topics and conversations that you guys are having, so this is why I wanted to actually have this space. First, can anybody, and I want to open this up to the whole room, talk to me a little bit about some of the downsides to being a creative inside this space. So I'd like to say, see, this is why I said there's a health conversation mm-hmm. inside here as well. You know, we try to do everything that we set out to, I'd say, with the best of intent. Mm-hmm. Now, what the execution ends up being, totally different. Where right. that goes, totally different. How it's interpreted, totally different. And that might play with your psyche. That might change how you feel, right? Can anybody talk to me a little bit about how you start off with the best of intentions? And then you just have to hope to see what people react towards. Ooh. Let's go through that and talk to me a little bit about some stories that might have happened.
That's where I'm going to start because, hold up.
Yeah.
This year beat my ass. I ain't even going to hold you. This year beat my ass. And I mean, as a creative, you're going to have these times where you're just misaligned with what you're trying to accomplish and how you feel inside. Mm. And so I think this year, everything felt as if it was like stripped away from me. Like I didn't have like, I couldn't like get any interviews. None of the shows I was trying to launch was getting off. I couldn't do any events because everybody's schedule was crazy and nobody just had the time to do it. And I was putting value on what I was able to produce, which is totally backwards way of thinking, because I think we've all been brainwashed by like capitalism and this creative space. Like people literally treat you as if you're valueless if they can't see your numbers or your following or what you created, who you're next to, how big your platform is. And so it's very easy to get attached to those meaningless definitions of what you're worth as a human being. And I think not being able to accomplish so much this year really taught me to be like, it don't matter what comes out of you, you're still just as valuable as if you did have a huge show on a large platform, if you did have a large following, if you have a bunch of retweets or whatever you are. Like, you can't put your value on like the end result, because the end results may not ever really produce or come into fruition. It doesn't mean anything about you. And so I think about my friend Jameer Pond. Like, every year he posts his hosting reel. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of like this celebratory, like reflective moment to be like, look at what I've done, and like really celebrating himself and the work that he's put out. But when I put my hosting reel, I realized it was a very old hosting reel. And I was trying to use that to get like new work. And I think the difference between him posting his reel and me posting mine was that his was progressive. His is like, this is what I've done and here's where I'm going. Mine was like, I'm valuable because I did this thing like all these years ago, and why won't anybody see me? And it was just like, that's not how you should go about your creative journey. Your creative journey starts with you here, now, and present. And what you're able to make, cool. If you're not, cool. You're still like, you're still that bitch. So that was a huge lesson for me. And I'm glad I had so much failure this year, quote unquote failure this year, to realize that, because now whatever comes from me, I've been that bitch, period.
Bomb drop. It's got to glow on that one. See, this is why, again, this is why we have static, because, you know, I see greatness inside there, too. It's like, all right, I'm going to let her get that off real quick, you know?
I'm going to piggyback off of you just because I kind of went through the same experience of, well, I thought this year was going to be the year. I'm not going to say that I thought I was getting a Grammy this year, because, you know, it takes time. But like, or busting through the doors and like getting all these followers like you were talking about and views on things. But I definitely thought this year was going to be like a breakthrough, and it was a breakdown. Ooh. And I was like, what is going on? 2019, what? And even on a personal scale, like I feel like I kept losing powerful players that I wanted to see. I wanted to see me on TV and on the radio, and like, you know, your elders like push the capitalist like view of like getting this job after college and like making your career something that's like a city job or a state job. And it's like, I don't want to do that. I want to create, and I want my platform to like be creative for other creatives. So I was just struggling with the fact that in my personal life too, I was losing so much, and like I wanted power players to see me. So I've just been struggling with the balance of even wanting to make sure you're giving your loved ones time, because you feel like so much, there's not enough time in the day to get what you're trying to get done. And then with podcasting, I started in February. It was like, artists get their voice taken away. You only want to be heard on your songs. Like, your audience only wants to hear what you got to spit or what you have to sing to. And then your views on society and lifestyle and all the other things on the side, they don't really care about. They just kind of want to even see it on video. They want to know your business on video for a minute, and that's it. They don't really want to know what you really feel inside. So for me, I wanted to still have my voice within sharing my voice on a song. And then that intention was like, well, you kind of do have to be mindful of what you say, because you're a public figure and you don't want people to still kind of judge you and say, oh, well, you're being really outlandish here. So with the intent of still having a voice, it was like, well, I can still offend people with my voice of sharing my opinions on how I feel. So I have to kind of soften up how I come across and my delivery, because I can be very strong in my delivery too, to where sometimes my opinions can come off as if I'm stating it as a fact. Hmm. So that's just where my balance has come in with, you know, trying to stay sane within me, wanting to just kind of share my voice and my opinions as well.
Right on. I hear that.
This year, I feel like women, you know, we just be on the same page. This shit fucked me up.
Damn.
I was like, yeah, I'm about to get up. This shit was like, psych,
sit down.
You thought.
Sit your head down.
Right. But this year, for me, one of the bigger things has been like just not being in competition. And not even with other people, but with myself. Because last year, this time, I believe I was coming back from doing my first live show in Chicago. So it was like, yo, I did less last year. I'm doing more this year. Why am I not seeing what I saw last year? My first year, live shows. I'm seeing sponsorships. It was just like, next year is going to be crazy. And it has been. I've met amazing people. I've had amazing conversations. But I sat back and I was just like, you must not be doing as much as you think. Because last year you were able to put out more content. You was doing more events. So I kind of was like really hard on myself until I really realized like I'm really planting seeds that if I had planted them last year, they might have not flourished the way they're going to flourish next year. You know what I mean? I had to be the person I am this year. I had to see what I saw. I had to lose who I lost in order for them to permanently flourish. You know what I mean? But it's just I've been hard on myself. Like this year, just it was really like I can look back now and say, I was in my head, like, yo, you're not moving quick enough. Last year, you was faster. Like, last year, around this time, look what you was doing. And it's kind of good, but it kind of hurts you. Well, it hurt me.
It can, right? And I think the lies that we tell ourselves, and I say lies in terms of that comparison culture, the big things, it's like, all right, I'm going to put this out, and it's going to be instantaneous. I'm going to be, you know, on a yacht with Diddy. We're going to do all the wild stuff, been around the world, whatever the case may be. But the erosion of that ego as that kind of comes through kind of informs that, okay, do you really want to do this or not? Because you have to take a look in the mirror and say, you know what? I'm putting this content out. I'm creating. I'm doing all the rest of this. And you might not get celebrated instantaneously. Then I got to look back at the story arc of what all art is. And I don't know anybody who was painting day one and got celebrated day one. Mm-hmm. I don't know anybody who was telling stories day one and got, you know, to that Grammy or that Oscar phase. And it was just like, yo, you put that out. You've done nothing else. Celebrate. And then how good would it be when you do cross those thresholds, right? So I have to ask those kind of questions. Corey, what you got on that?
We have seen some people blow up really early, and they usually end up being trash.
They're usually not there very long.
Yeah, and so it's one of those things where as a creative, especially when you get to the point where you're really trusting yourself to be a creative and not trying to do like another safe job, not trying to like pay bills doing some other thing, then you get to that point where you have to also make the decision, I know that this is going to make me money. I know that this is going to get me clicks, but this shit is trash. You have to like decide, do I do the thing that's really my creative vision and the thing that I want to do, or do I do the thing that moves units and sells whatever I'm selling, you know? And that's one of the harder parts about giving yourself over to being a creative is deciding to do your own work versus the work that you know is going to make the money, or finding that balance of, okay, this will make me money and I also get to do my thing, you know, and then being patient enough to allow the things to come to you from what you're building instead of trying to keep pace with like the new hot shit that's about to move one time and then you'll never see them again. Well, how come I don't have, you know, all of this going on, but you may not see that person next year.
Yeah, it's a hard space to be in and hard to maintain that artistic integrity as you're going through there, right? So there's always going to be that, here's the place that I wanted to be, here's where I ended up, and then that comparison usually happens somewhere in between there. Noelle, you brought something up about offending people, and you brought something up about going inside of that space where you got to kind of try to change yourself a little bit to soften some of how other people are doing that. Now, me personally, if you are a new listener to the show, I'm sorry to tell you, if you're waiting for me to do that at any point in time, that is never going to happen.
Exercise your patience.
That's what I was about to say. You got a long-ass time to wait before I change me. No, that's never going to happen. And we had a brush with that recently as well. Again, I believe in civil liberties. I will defend civil liberties end to end. I also think that you should be accountable for whatever you choose to dive into, right? So for me personally, if you're going to judge me by what I say, judge me by what I do, judge me by my intent, and then judge me by my outcome, right? I'm totally fine with that. And I would happily debate anybody that wants to come across there, but you got to come correct. Because you know, if I got to pay attention to it, I'm going to start to scrutinize on the other side. And my race to zero is very quick. I'm ready to get there. It's like, all right, cool. We're going to go through here. We're going to go through this. And I'm okay with whatever has to come about that. But that's intense as a creative. Trying to see, am I trying to please all these people out here? Am I trying to speak freely? And then when you do, sometimes you get that pushback. Latasha, I know people be pushing you back.
They try, and I close the app, and they can't talk to me no more.
See? Exactly, right? Can y'all talk to me about how you deal with scrutiny? How you manage, here's what I said, here's what you heard, and then how the whole wave is going to start coming through. I know you've been in Twitter jail
a
couple times.
She shut the app down and going by the day. She just told you.
No longer
exists.
Like,
nope,
I'm sorry.
I've seen the video that she posted, like, if you don't like what I'm saying, just close it. You don't got
to
be here.
Easy, right?
You don't have to be here, and I don't have to hear you. This is a very simple relationship we all could have with each other.
You know somebody kept clicking that, like, I know she didn't just say that.
She
said it. Yeah, she did. She said it again. She said it again.
I'm in these comments. You better, what?
I'm gonna be super honest with you guys and transparent here that it's been rough. Like, I have been in spaces where I'm trying to please my audience, or what I even think my audience is, or who my audience is. So now that I'm like totally in a revamping space of, no, I need to figure out who my audience is, it's as if I didn't even know who they were. So obviously what I was doing and trying to please people wasn't right in the first place for me. So I'm at a total like reset with everything in my career. So my project manager, who I just linked up with and solidified that, she told me, you have longevity. So the instant gratification that you may feel like you want, because it happens. You see your peers around you, like literally your peers, people that you know that you can reach, hang out with. They're doing what you're doing, different way, different journey, but ultimately the same goal. You guys are want to sit at the same table, break bread together, change the world together, and you're not where they are. So you start to compare yourself, and I had to take myself out of that. Like, even taking the silver spoon out of my mouth in certain things, because I've been very fortunate as a kid to have, but in your creative space, you don't get that. It's a whole different ballgame.
You know how rare it is to have a fortunate kid from the Bronx?
That's what I was about to say. I was like, wait a minute.
Every time I say it, I'd be like,
what part of the Bronx is, what street is that?
She's with Cologeno and them up there.
Y'all need a dime a day?
Out there.
What street is that?
Yeah.
But I've had to, because the silver spoon I had, my family was very much like, go to college, be a doctor, be a teacher. And they're not really for the, let me support you all the way in your music career. It's different.
Yeah.
So you kind of have to force it out, because then the expectation I have is to get all the benefits of being the doctor and being the teacher and going on that journey. And I'm not. So they don't really view it the same.
Yeah.
So I've had to kind of just essentially rob myself of some things that I feel that I wanted or deserve to have to get to where I needed to go, and then do it on my own, in a sense. So I'm just going through a whole revamping process, but longevity was something that stood with me. So when kids like gravitate towards me, I really jump on that, because I'm like, well, y'all have a whole lot of years to go, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So if I plant my seeds in you guys and then be a community member, be involved in the youth, it'll carry my lyrics so far. Like, it'll be like, you know, the greats that we know today. The Patties, the Gladys's.
Okay, we got a high bar.
Yeah.
We got a high, high
bar. You're trying to make pie.
Pies.
Yeah.
So you making pie.
Yeah, I'm trying.
Because you got to sing your ass off if you're making pie.
That, yeah.
But listen, okay. No, not pie. You know, I'm not into sweets pies like that. But, you know, I'm trying to make them turkey legs, some collard greens.
Here we go.
You're going
to get it right.
Patty feeds that to us. Patty do not.
She don't be eating that shit.
Patty does not eat that shit.
She don't.
One thing I want to tell you, like, as a woman, to be careful about changing yourself to please an audience. Because if you could see the different reactions between what you and Tony had, I think men are groomed to, or they're celebrated when they're themselves and they have that harsh opinion. It's just like, I don't give a fuck. Yeah, I like it or you don't. Like, you have the Simon Cowells, the Charlemagne, the Howard Sterns, and people, or the Joe Rogans. Like, when you have that harsh opinion, when you have something to say, men are like celebrated.
appreciated for that.
And women can't.
Women, on the other hand, are not. Yeah. Unless you're like a Wendy Williams who just, she stuck to her guns and what her personality is. And she became, now she was known as that host that she can use.
Even
and
Cardi
celebrate.
B, like to kind of level it out with the artistry of like music. Right. She's very much like honored for that. And
right, but that's also racialized too, which I don't know if I have the time to get into that.
I mean,
but,
see what we do with powerful women who want to speak their mind
and be your mind.
But when you're watching this, it's like
women are groomed to like be softer and be people pleasing and to give and to change and to nurture. And if you're going to be a media personality, it's imperative that you know your voice, you love your voice. And if that audience doesn't match what your voice is, that's okay.
And that was the intent in the first place. So I don't want to lose
because the audience will always change their opinion. Then you'll soften yourself and you'll give this, and the audience is like, well, she ain't really always be something.
She ain't real
You might as well say what you want to say.
You know what though, I remember a specific conversation I had on the show with a friend, and I remember sitting there and I was thinking to myself, like, there's certain things that I want to say, I'm just not sure I should say. And that was the day that I was like, I got to figure this out. Because if I can't be honest with y'all, you probably shouldn't listen to me anyway. So then I like started tweeting it. And then I said it on air. And I remember the first time I said it, I was like, they're going to kill me. But I was just like, you know what? I don't even care. Because I remember sitting in, and it was actually a topic about like trans people.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't nothing disrespectful, you know what I'm saying? But I just was like, well, people are gonna, they gonna kill me if I say this shit. And I was just like, after the interview, I remember tiptoeing around it. I said, yo, I don't even care. I don't even care. Because if you're not gonna listen, you're not gonna listen. At this point, I'm doing whatever I gotta do to maintain anyway. It ain't like, what you gonna do? You gonna take me out the studio? No.
Right.
I'm gonna just do that shit. And it kind of, I tweeted it, and I remember they was on it. And I was like, I don't care. I'm gonna say it anyway.
Right.
But I remember sitting there, and that was the day I was like, yo, am I gonna not say what I feel? Because somebody's going to be upset I ain't say it. Somebody's going to be upset I did say it. But how do I feel in the studio? And that's when I was like, yo, I got to say what I feel. Even like when you came on the show, I remember when I wrote out, like, I don't write my questions, but I remember writing topics I wanted to talk about. And I asked you, like, does the studio own your work? And I was like, I don't want my man to be offended.
No.
But it's something that I do want to know. And I was like, you know what? We're going to see.
Hell yeah. And we play this game transparent, you know? Yeah. If you can live in your truth, can't nobody use it against you.
Right.
Right? And I totally appreciate those responses. Corey, look like you had something on that. Challenge, you got something on that.
Well, like in this space, I have a couple of extra privileges, you know? But in the same sense, I have no choice but to be honest about how I feel about things. And I don't think for me or for any of us, we need to apologize for an opinion we have. Because even if you say the opinion you have at that time, you get new information and that opinion changes. Mm-hmm. Then, okay, that's my new opinion, but I still felt this then. So the whole idea of like backtracking and trying to cover what you may have said or try to make people feel better, I focus on clearly expressing what I have to say, not necessarily saying the thing that'll make people happy. I want to be able to succinctly and clearly express exactly how I feel and all the nuance related to it so that I can then go back and argue that point if someone has contention with it. But what I'm not going to do is try to give you the opinion that you want to hear, because I can't defend that. I can't defend an opinion that I made up to help you. I can only defend an opinion because I don't have a good memory. So you're going to come back and ask me about something I did 8 episodes ago. I can tell you what I'm going to say because I would have said that same thing most likely. I can't defend some shit I made up. I'm not even going to remember I said it.
And there's a difference between being like responsible with your words and being wrong, or just trying to be offensive, which we're starting to see like an uptake in that. People just trying to have like these stark opinions to be the next guy or whatever, to get those retweets, to get that quick fame. And it's just like, it comes off disingenuous and you just look ignorant and make people mad at you.
How do you differentiate that? You know, what the intent is on the other side. I do think there's an authenticity space inside there, but I also do want to go back. I don't know if you guys heard that, like, it wasn't a direct compliment, but I was mentioned explicitly after some great men, as she said in there. And, you know, coming from Latasha, I'm going to take that compliment, you know. But I'm going to go back to that part where it wasn't abrasive. You know, how do you get into the space where...
He going to find a compliment. He found one.
I took it. I took it because it's not going to come. It's not on the other side.
He ruffled through the brushes real quick. He dug in the back of your drawer.
I think you said something nice there. I think I found a compliment.
I was like, yeah, I'm going to take that. I'm going to take some credit on that.
That was 100% not me.
Yeah, exactly. It was like, word. I see that there. All right, cool. But how do you decide, okay, maybe it's somebody on your platform that says something crazy. Maybe it's the way that it's interpreted. How do you understand, okay, here's what you intended to do. Here's what the crowd is going through. And okay, now something might have been bad that came out of that, but the intent was still to get you over here.
Yeah.
How do you see through that?
I'm going to use Charlamagne as an example. There are times where like you can tell that he's grown and listened to his audience and listened to Black women, and he's like changed. Like he's trying to be like, or he's becoming like this mental health voice. And there was a time, and we can see that sometimes Charlamagne just doesn't know things, or he's just ignorant, or that he's just a product of where he's come from. And to have that platform with those old ideas, old morals, old opinions, you know, the audience is going to hold you responsible for that. So, like, he'll invite a Janet Mock on the show, have this huge conversation about trans awareness and trans issues, and then he'll invite one of his ignorant friends to come on the show and erase that entire conversation. Mm. So you're being presented with information, and then you're still leaning into making those wrong mistakes. Mm. That's when you're trying to be intentionally offensive for those views or for those laughs or for that quick moment, right? But if you decide to be presented with information and you lean in, I think that's when it becomes, like, disingenuous. Like, okay, you're just here to, like, be the anti-person and, like, you know, have that visibility on you.
Get a punchline off, something like that.
Yeah, and it's corny and dated and boring.
I hear you on that. Young Jones, what you got on the situation, man?
I mean, as y'all can see, like, I'm not out here saying more than I should ever. Like, you know what I'm saying? I only speak when I feel the need to. And I feel like a part of that is just being the only child. Like, if I say some shit, then I mean it, period. Like, I'm not about to go out here and try to be something that I'm not. Like, I'm authentically going to be me. And I think being a creator in this space, I had to learn very early that once you put something out there, it's no longer yours at all, right? So once I put something online, anybody could take it, anybody could interpret it how they want it, anybody could, you know, get offended by it. But like at the end of the day, that's how it made you feel. That's what art is at the end of the day, is I put something out and it made you feel a way, period. So I don't really hold any attachment to it. And y'all know, like, going through this yoga teacher training and all that shit, like, I don't attach to nothing, like, unless I want to be attached to it. So once I say it, I said it. You want to debate about it? You want to argue, like, in person or on phone? Like, I'm going to put my phone down. Like, I'm not about to talk to you. In person, I'm going to walk away from you. Like, it's just, it is what it is. But if you want to have a straight up conversation, then we can have that conversation. Like, I can admit when I'm wrong. I can admit when I did something wrong. But if I didn't do it intentionally to get likes or to get clicks or to do anything outlandish, then fuck out my face, bro. Like, that's literally how it is.
See, that's why I like the way he balances that hood opulence with the yoga, you know? He's like, I'm gonna do that. But then get the fuck out of my
that's
face.
That's when you get that organic thug. That's what organic does. It comes banging on avocados.
You know, exactly. OT over there.
I admire you, Corey, though, for bringing up the fact that you said you want to execute your thoughts properly and your feelings, because me and Lee talk about this all the time, that we want the world to get to a space where men can feel, because just like we talked about what women, you know, don't get admired for having their strong voice and strong opinions, men don't get admired for feeling and sharing their feelings. And they need safe spaces to do that. So I admire that you said that, and I admire you for using your platform to say that, because you're going to attract more men to stand up and want to execute a healthy way of expressing how they feel and getting it all out on the table, because you deserve to.
Thank you.
You deserve to.
For me, it's also, I, again, have the privilege of no one's questioning certain things about me. Mm-hmm. So I look a certain way. Like, I'm a big dude with dreads. I come off a certain way. So you're not going to be like, oh, he's gay because he's emotional. Like, I don't get a lot of the things that men worry about, mm-hmm. because I just naturally, that's not a thing you're going to easily question for me. So my masculinity doesn't come into question easily because of the way my natural demeanor is. The way I sound helps me not be questioned in, like, being weak. You know, so a lot of the things that I can express, I can also comfortably express because I'm in less of a danger of being judged in the same manner. I take advantage of the fact that I have this privilege and use the platform to do that, because I have an easier chance saying things than someone who had a different demeanor would. You know what I mean?
I mean, I think to piggyback on that, when you talk about masculinity, I feel like it's judged in very shallow things like respect, athleticism, like the things that you have, like, oh, this nigga got a
he can rap
crazy
rim, he's
whip.
The man.
Yeah, you know what I mean? And that's taught early, like when you're a child. So as you get older, I feel like when you have the perceived look of somebody that's respected, that's one of the main reasons I got into this yoga space. It's like there was nobody that looked like me. Any black people that taught yoga or men in general were typically gay. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but I didn't see me or anybody that represented me. So it's like, I gotta be that person, right? And I feel like that's the only way that that safe space can open. That's the only way that conversation can open is from people who are perceived as, I said this before, like if you're threatening or if you're the alpha male and it's like, oh, he can do that? All right, maybe I can do that too then. And that's the only way that happens, unfortunately.
Yeah, and in that destigmatizing, you got to realize that a lot of these conversations are brand new, at least for people that you're talking about in this generation coming through this whole safe space for men's topic is so new that you're not going to get perfection right out the gate. So I do hear that some people are like missing up or taking steps and they're tripping, but you also got to be like, if you want to have change happen, you have to open the conversation. I think a lot of people are quick to point the finger. Barack Obama was just talking about this.
But I do get a sense sometimes now among certain young people, and this is accelerated by social media, there is this sense sometimes of the way of me making change is to be as judgmental as possible about other people. And that's enough. Like if I tweet or hashtag about how you didn't do something right or used the word wrong verb or then I can sit back and feel pretty good about myself because, man, you see how woke I was? I called you out.
It's like, all right, y'all are a little too woke in certain spaces. It's like, yes, this person is wrong. Okay, how do you educate? How do you take that education and transition that into action? And then how do we evolve on that same space? It's in a continuum. If you just say this person is bad and we throw them away, I don't know if about you, but we got not that many people that we can throw away right now.
Or expecting them to just get it right the first time.
Out the gate, you know? So open up the conversation, open up for dialogue and keep that evolving, you know? And I think true art allows that to start to bridge those gaps. And true art allows you to start to push into different spaces. It might be uncomfortable initially, but if you're okay with it, we can get in that uncomfortable space and start to make something a little bit more resound start to happen.
I think one of the biggest steps we can make for making safe spaces for everyone, men, women, anyone who needs safety within the conversation, is getting rid of the idea of cancel culture. Because you have to give people room to reform. I'm not going to come to you and apologize for a mistake if I know that apology then ends my ability to speak. And the idea that you have to identify who your actual allies are and stop attacking them, even if your ally is making a mistake trying to help you. You know, because sometimes people will try to assist you, whether it be, you know, a man in a trying to support a female space, white people trying to support the space of people of color. You see people who are trying to be an ally make a mistake or be way more judged than you would judge your actual given enemy. You know this person is your enemy. You think this person is your ally. Why are you coming for the ally first? So there's a lot of the idea of safe spaces that we have to understand that you have to be safe inside of that quote unquote safe space. So when you're in that space and men say some things we've had that experience as a collective where one of the men will say something and we're a little taken aback by it. We didn't expect to hear that.
Because old ears kick in.
Because old
like,
ears kick in.
Old ears is like, yo, word, that's where you at?
Like, is he?
Ah,
and then you have to remind yourself, because that happened.
Exactly.
One of our friends started giving us some real serious information about his life, and I immediately, my inner judge was like, damn, you
get
just
him.
Said that? And then I was like, yo, hold up.
That's not why we're here.
You're supposed to be here to hear this. You can't hear this and then have that opinion. But you have to get past it. You don't just decide to be woke and now every decision you make is the right one now. You're still going to make mistakes. Mm-hmm. So you have to just police yourself and at the same time allow people to fuck up. You know, you first learning to walk, you're going to fall sometimes. Let them fall. Pick them back up. Keep it going.
There we go.
I mean, I also feel like it's very multifaceted as well. Like, you think of something like the music that we listen to, like I love 90s hip hop, but it was very offensive to women. And it's like, we stepping into 2019. A song that was made back then, not going to fly this day.
Yeah, you can't
this day and age.
To this day.
Still, hip hop is still.
Yeah.
I mean, still. I'm not saying that it's not.
Worse. I think it's a little more blatant now than it was before, where it was kind of like.
R&B is definitely just stop trying.
R&B is not.
You know what the big difference is? The big difference is 90s editing.
Yes.
So, like, if you go back and play an old 90s song, you can have, like, the word faggot not edited out. But now it is. And, like, they'll edit out nigga and then say, like, another racial slur. Like, it's the old editing was different. We weren't aware of all the terms because, like, the negative, all the derogatory homosexual terms was still in hip hop heavy and were not edited out. So you'll hear, like, a clean version of an old Biggie song and be like, yo.
Yeah.
Like, I've played tracks in my class and then been like, oh, I can't play that song no more. Damn, I can't play that song because that's the clean version, you know, because the idea of what was offensive didn't even occur in the 90s.
But I even think, like, even with TV shows and things like that, like, we're allowed to say certain things on air publicly where, like, back then it wasn't like a lot, you weren't allowed to say it. It was bleeped out. So, I mean, I do agree with you in hip hop, like a lot of derogatory words were able to be used. But I do think like when you brought up women, Jones, I feel like women are a little bit more degraded in music now publicly than it was before. Like even the sacred kind of conversations of, you know, kind of underlyingly talking about sex or underlyingly talking about bodies and what they look like and the attractiveness to them.
I don't disagree by any means.
Oh, no, it's definitely.
But I feel like that same, with that same token, that song could be played and women are still dance to it. You know what I mean? Or men are still dance to it. And everybody will still accept it as like, yo, that new Meg Thee Stallion shit is fire. You know what I'm saying? But it's like everybody dancing to it, but it could have negative connotations to it. So it's more along the lines of that conversation being you can't be woke in this one particular part of life and then not over here too. You know what I mean? Like it has to be all encompassing, and that's the point that I was kind of I was getting to.
Basically, at least there's some balanced music now. At least there's some music on the other end that's bringing you some kind of, because that I think like that music is always going to exist in some fashion. The difference is how much the culture is accepting, and obviously the music is. I think that people think that the music is the forefront of the culture, and a lot of times it's just a reflection of it. So some of the more soulful, more woke music has been coming out because the culture has been a little more woke. So it's not, we don't have to just wait for Common to make another album to hear something.
Please
you
don't.
Know what I mean?
I love that brother, but please don't stop. Just stop all together, fam. Like you picked up the acting. I want you to just go ahead, put the mic down.
I don't
want to
see
just move
films
forward.
No more either.
That's what I'm saying. Like you just, nah, chill. And that's coming from a space of love.
Yeah.
You know, Petey Riso from the South Side of Chicago was a real important person. Past that third album, I don't know who he is anymore. You know?
That song where he got his crib robbed, I got my crib robbed at the same time.
You know,
I felt him.
I understand what he was at.
Chicken in my house, though. If he'd ate some chicken, I'd have came for him.
Somebody had to get busted. But we talking about artists elevating and feeling a different level of responsibility. We got multi-hyphenated artists inside here. How do you feel about the content that you put out? Do you police yourself in that high level of scrutiny with like, okay, I got to come in with my message. I got to also entertain and I got to also do all the rest of this stuff. Seems like you're building up higher and higher hurdles that none of the other contemporaries seem to actually have to put any kind of effort and attention to on the other side. So we just had another homie who was in here who talked about his social responsibility to some of his stuff that he was doing. And he was like, yeah, I'm not personally trying to do that. I don't really care about social impact on that side. Not to say that disparagingly, but he had the freedom to do that. It was like, I got to be representative of this class. I got to be representative of that. And I got to hold all the rest of this context. Like, realize we're holding a lot more weight. So how do you navigate that and still be true to your art?
I don't think it's a hurdle at all. And I think that's where I'm clashing with a bunch of people. Like, I made a video about Dave Chappelle and him using trans people as the butt of his joke. And I got a lot of pushback from that. And everybody really wants to fight to make fun of trans people. And I don't ever feel like if somebody comes to me and says, hey, Tosh, those are not my pronouns. I'm sorry. I'm start calling you they. Hey, Tosh, I don't really identify as a lady. Can you call me? My pronouns are this and that or whatever. I don't ever like want to fight to be wrong, to be wrong, or to go against a certain group of people. Like, I don't think it takes a lot of energy to be like, "Hey, Tasha, we don't go by Spanish. We go by Latinx because that includes a bunch of like Latin cultures from different areas and X, Y, and Z." Cool. So let me talk about the Latinx community, and I just make these adjustments. I really don't understand what like the fight is about. Like, why are we fighting to like keep an old way of like verbiage or labels or identities? Like, shit's changing. Like, the only reason why it's difficult is because you're going against the grain. Like, shit's changing, be wrong, and then make the move to change.
I think the biggest push is people who haven't had to admit they're wrong before.
Yeah.
Ever.
And that's just all ego. Like, well, I'm not a bad guy because I called you a man and you're really a woman now. And it's just like, nobody said that, babe. Just say trans woman. Like, that's
the reality is you're having a conversation with people who have never had to apologize for what they've said ever.
Yeah.
Or they've like, never had to feel that.
Yeah.
Also
yeah,
true.
They've never had to feel what that feels like.
And I think some of the arguments have some level of validity as far as being able to speak without worrying as much about offending people, but everyone has the right to be addressed the way they choose. So once you've been informed, you are now responsible.
Right.
Prior to your information, if you actually remain ignorant to the idea of different pronouns and all the different things that people can be offended by and all those different subjects, then by all means, I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt until you've been informed. But at that point, now you're responsible.
Yeah. And like, I'm trying to, and it's, adjusting is not easy. I'll say that as well. Adjusting really isn't easy because even when I'm trying to just give an opinion, maybe like on the grapevine or something like that, and I'll be like, and men and women, and then in the back of my mind, I'm like, should I say non-binary? And how do I address that? And how does that come out? And then like, I'm stuttering and tripping over my words because I'm stuck on like trying to address like the non-binary gender and like be inclusive of everyone. Like, even when we opened this show, I was like, and I wanted to be like, should I say and non-binary babies? Like, you know what I mean? Like,
and I didn't. And again, that's why I would say go back to my intent.
Habit, yeah.
Because that's in a habit. Yeah. So first of all, you even brought up the idea of Spanish, right? Now that I know is a third rail term today, right? I've lived 33 years as a black Spanish person. Yeah. Latinx was something that was given to me, I'd say maybe 5 years ago, in a collegiate setting, and it's now popularized, I'd say, in the last 2-3 years as a common colloquialism. My language has had 33 years to not have that
yes,
in there.
Yes, exactly.
So my name, I have a Latin name, right? I can't get past it without, right? Everything is inside there. We used to just call Spanish. And it got to a certain point, it was like, you can be black or Spanish. Mm. We're going to lean into this black side because no cop is going to be like, look at that Latin man across the street walking up there. So my identity is complex. Now I have better language to describe some of this complexity, but I get criticized on that same side too. It's like, no, you said this, you do that. And I was like, well, hold on. I had a whole ass life before we got to this enlightened place. I'm trying to be better and I'm trying to be inclusive inside that same space. So judge me where the intent is going. Am I saying a derogatory statement immediately following something that I would describe myself as? No. So where can we go? How do you inform? How do you educate? How do you help me be better? That's what I want to do inside that space. And, you know, yeah, I want to get another 33 years on that. And hopefully I never use any of these other terms. Because that's hard.
And the terms are always going to change. Because even people are starting to be like, well, we don't really use Latinx on this side over here. So
that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
It's hard. First of all, there's masculine and feminine verbs inside the language.
Yeah.
It's going to be hard for me to add a bunch of other context inside there when you gave me this is the only way that you can speak this language with all these different rules and regulations. Unless we're going to remix everything. Okay, now I need to have a third tense across the whole board. It's hard.
You wanted to get like 6 or 7.
That's what I'm saying. My Rosetta Stone ain't that deep yet. You know, I'm still trying to figure this out.
Latinx is only 18 months old for me.
Fam!
The term queer is maybe 3 years old for me. The first time I heard it, I was like, hey, man, you're not allowed to say that. And dude was like, no, that's me. I'm allowed to say it. I was like, hold on, what?
Help me out. Help me out.
Because I'm sorry, what?
I thought that, you know, so we're trying to educate.
I just say people.
Right.
I just run with people. When I refer to humans, I just say people now.
Some people say folk.
Yeah. Now I'm going to say that. I'm going to start to be more inclusive in that.
That's why you hear me say humans and people be like, humans, you can't argue human. You human, right?
Right. All right,
cool. We're going to go with that.
As you know, I'm leading diversity and inclusion in a company that I work for. So we had a meeting and everybody had to address or say what their pronouns were. This was my first setting and everybody's going around like, oh, this shit coming around to me. I don't know what. You know, I'm completely ignorant to that because that's not something that I've been a part of in that world. So I had to ask the group, like, yo, like, you know, enlighten me on this space, because I'm green in here. Like, I identify as a straight male, like a black male, but that's what you see me as. You know what I'm saying? Like, I've never had to say that. So it was just kind of like, all right, well, let me learn. You know what I'm saying? Like, that was it.
Can I jump in real quick?
Go for it.
Because I've just been sitting here and taking it all in pause.
See, even that.
Listen.
We got to talk about this.
First off, that pause was mad layered. We got to break that pause down a lot. You know there's a lot going into that we got to talk about.
See?
Listen. What was that? That was a heterosexual pause.
Yes.
That was like a reverse pause.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, I take everything from that. I make everything.
You got to repurpose it.
I take everything.
I'm totally down with straight people being made fun of because y'all suck. So.
Yo, that's what's up.
I take everything from straight people. You know what I'm saying? But we'll get into that. But I was sitting here and I was thinking, and like, I'm an ally of bearded people. And like, I'm a fan of your beard, Corey. But Mr. Jones, like, when I hear you speak, I hear Ari Lennox in my ear, like, Shea Bug, babe. Yep. Like, it's just, I just was like, God damn it. What's happening over here? But anyhow, right? So yeah, you know, I can't stay on that too long because that my audience don't want me to. So what I am hearing and from what I've experienced, all the language, all of it, it's like relearning everything you know, like relearning how to walk, relearning how to speak to someone. I've had friends come to me and be like, hey, Lee, this is not what I go by anymore. And every time I mess up, I feel like the worst person in the world. Like I'll be like, listen, I'll mess up and be like, hold on, because remember 2 years ago, I was saying that and you was fine.
Yeah.
I don't mean to offend anyone, but I also feel like people are just so quick to be like, oh, you fucked up. You fucked up. Get the fuck out of here. They be like, she fucked up. Get her the fuck out of here. Like, I'd be like, damn, I really, and then I'm horrible. I'm horrible in everyday life. With like I teach children, you know how many times? Hey, Jerome, you sir in the blue sweatshirt. Like I don't get it right in everyday life, so I be trying to explain to my friends and my peers and people that I meet. It may be something that is inevitable right now, but please bear with me. And from just doing that, and I always tell people, I'll start sentences off with love. Like, listen, with love, I forgot what you told me to call you. That's kind of helped. But I can see how in everyday life, things are fast. Mm-hmm. So it's like you won't always get there. I just want people to just be more patient with each other. Let's just be more patient with each other. Because it's hard. It's hard. I've tried to change my damn pronouns just because I was like, you know what? I think this is cool. I forgot my own damn pronouns. So,
man.
So we just back at she. Just back at she. I forgot. Somebody asked me, like, yo, Lee, what you say you wanted to be called? I was like, damn, I forgot.
Lee? Just go, Lee.
Yeah.
Just good looking Lee. Hey,
I was like, I forgot. It's that.
Good looking Lee. Lee looking good. Go with that. Just give me that.
Oh, my God.
What'd you call me yesterday? Call me that. I forgot.
There we
go. Yo, real talk, though, is so confusing. I switched, maybe about a year ago, I switched my email to, like, he, him, right? So I put that at the end of my signature, and then someone informed me that that could be a problem for people, because if you do that within like a corporation and then everyone starts taking that on, then you force people to identify themselves and therefore out themselves. Mm. And I was like,
see, that's the level of meta that I would have been. Oh. Somebody had to tell me about that.
So then I was like, all right, so what, do I take it off now? And the response from her was just be aware. I was like, all right, so I'm going to write it down. And then if somebody asked me, I'm going to be like, you said it was cool? Like, you got me? Like, who's backing me up if somebody called me out? Can I be like, yo, she said it was cool.
Take it up with her. She told me it was fine.
I know for a fact it's a her. I checked on that. It's a her, and she said this was cool. Like, I don't know what to
it
do.
It don't
sometimes.
Matter what you do. It doesn't matter what you do. But, moving with intent and, you know, just doing your best. For me, that's where I'm at right now. That got to work. That gotta work.
I look at it like I try to treat myself in that space the way I treat white people when they try to do the right thing and sometimes make that mistake. I look at it like that. All right, I saw where you messed up, so don't do that. Here's what you're going to do instead. And then I just ask for that in the same space. Right. You know, because in somewhere you're going to be the person who doesn't know. You're always going to be the unaware person in some kind of different circumstance. So I always compare it to that because that I know. And I know what you shouldn't have said.
It's right. An exchange, you know? In that space, right? they know. They just got it. They just got it in the bag. They had long enough. I was about to say, we have to be able to have an exchange, you know? But apparently
you got
not.
Hella
you have
black
to know.
People creating, explaining blackness to y'all ass. Y'all can watch Grownish every Thursday on ABC7
and get it decoded.
But you know what? I don't watch Friends to try to figure out white people.
We don't have to. We've been assimilated to have to figure out white people.
It's clear and present.
Next.
You're right here.
I got a funny story for you guys, based off of what Tony originally asked about, like, you know, your platform and like how do you balance everything out. And I was on Twitter one day and I got like a retweet or a comment, and it was like, stop retweeting that nasty stuff, Jesus is watching you. And oh, right,
yo, if Jesus is in Black Twitter, that's crazy. A different level.
What's crazy is my Twitter is, you know, like what Twitter is for pretty much everyone. You just write out your thoughts and like what's going on moment to moment, how you feeling and stuff like that. So I'll retweet, you know, the nasty stuff that he was talking about. And right after that, I was doing a basic income march for lower income, you know, people just trying to have a balance of having $1,000 a month given to them to kind of just like motivate them to keep working, motivate them to keep supporting their families, but still have some safety net for them to survive, right? And all their connections is through Twitter, so BronxNet TV, the Basic Income March people, they're like following me on Twitter, like retweeting me and like this like picture of me in like a Sunday's Best kind of vibe, like, you know, promoting the event. And that's like, you know, the look that would make sense to market, you know, out of all my pictures in my portfolio and stuff. And then I'm thinking like, wait, I was just retweeting that nasty stuff though. So are they going to tap in and see that? And I remember me writing a tweet like, yeah, I just did this Basic Income March. I love y'all all, but y'all going to have to accept me for, you know, the things that like I connect to on a personal note and the things I connect to professionally, because I want to be super transparent that I'm human, you know? I got feelings, I got hormones, I got all that stuff going on with me, but I'm in no way trying to be offensive by it or even taking away from the fact that I do have a model structure to me that supports children and their growth in a timely fashion. So not being involved in things you shouldn't be involved in too soon and, you know, doing right by, you know, the kids and things like that, even though I don't sing kids about music or anything like that. But I do have child-friendly music. Like, you know, I don't curse too much in my records. I'm not exploiting sex in my records. You know, I do have my little racy times, my freestyles, you know, I give it all. But I'm really focused on that part of like longevity. But that stood out to me because people really do want you to look a certain way or sound a certain way with how you come across in your craft, in your art.
Yeah, they want you to.
Noelle. She's gonna talk, okay? Noelle's gonna talk, okay? Yo. But none of that story funny. But she gonna talk. Well, but I appreciate it. I appreciate the story.
So that's the thank me later show.
I want to point out how smoothly Lee cooked that microwave. Though she grabbed the bottom of the nightstand and slid that.
She always gotta find some way on air to like diss me and tell me I ain't funny.
It's gonna be in there.
But you laughed about the tweet.
Yeah. It was all in there. It's one of those things that, first of all, y'all are hysterical.
Shout out to that mic slide, though. That was smooth. You ain't even hear it move. It was just in front of
her. Ain't nobody listening to you.
It was just in front of her.
Wow. That's deep.
She took a deep breath before she did it, too. Like,
but at least I got to the point, though. At least I got to the point.
I appreciate where you was going with that. You know, I see how you evolved your artistry in that whole space. You know, and again, y'all artistry in this next recording that y'all have to do is going to be a different type of level. I can see it already, you know? Where... If there was the, I'd say, highest of aspirations, where do you guys want to go in these next spaces? What are the challenges that you're seeing right now in whatever avenues that you're creating that you say, you know what, I want to get to this space. I want to be able to open this up and I'm daring to express myself freely as I'm creating, regardless of who's judging. What's that story sound like? Either one of y'all can jump on.
Aspirations, definitely, well, one with music, just to kind of change the world with my sound. I think that music is super powerful in communicating and connecting ideas and unifying people, and we need that. Like, we definitely need that. And Lee tells me all the time, you know, because she likes to shade me, I'm gonna expose her, that my voice is needed. So in whatever aspect it's needed for, I definitely want to hold to that. So I've taken away some of the material things and even the awards type of thing. I know so many people that don't get the accolades that we set that are the highest of accolades, and they do a damn good job at doing their job and being a huge influence. And yeah, that's pretty much as far as I want to go. The challenges, though, to cycle back to the top of the conversation with Latasha saying followers and just viewers.
Clout.
Those are challenges, because even the people that you want to sit in the room with to kind of discuss your ideas and get the execution done, those like CEOs, executives and things like that, they want those expectations. I've ran into that. Like certain radio stations saying, oh, we're watching you. We want to wait to see if you get to these followers and see your views go up. So that's probably one of my biggest challenges as a musician. And yeah.
My aspirations, honestly, I just want the youth, primarily black youth and, you know, adults, but I want to show people from the ghetto, like where I'm from, that you can do anything that sounds outlandish. It doesn't matter. Like, and I know that's super cliche, but that's why, like, I try so hard to, like, I do a lot of community stuff because I want people to see, like, yo, she really is one of us. Like, she's really from the projects just like us. I want to focus on the same way gentrification is just rebuilding the neighborhood to give it to somebody who was not there. I want to just build up my community that I'm from, build up communities all over that are, you know, we're going to go with malnourished in all kinds of ways. I want to help them. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's what I want to do. I want to create spaces all over to where the youth that and their families who live in malnourished spaces, they can come and they can learn and they can create. That's like, when I get that done, I'm going to be just like one of them washed celebrities. I'm going to be Snapchatting and Instagram storying mad water. Like, yo, y'all never had water this clear. I know. I work for
you're gonna
it.
You're going to be on podcast squares.
You know what I'm saying? Like, that's the shit that I want to do. I want to. Y'all I want my voice. Yeah, clear. Like, I'm going to be like, I remember the water was dirty. You know how shit celebrities do that shit? Yeah, I remember I used to eat oodles and noodles. Shit like that. But I want to help people from the ghetto. You know what I'm saying? I want my voice and my team that I handcraft from upcoming artists to be able to handle any space that they're in. That's it.
That's what's up. All right. Just Latasha.
I've spent majority of this year asking spaces outside of myself to validate me.
Oh, it's getting good. Come on. Come on.
She take that podium.
Come on. Talk, queen.
And really having to find my value outside of those things confirmed that I am an Oprah. I am an Issa Rae. I am the answer I've been looking for this entire time. And my biggest aspiration is to own a TV network, TV channel. And I think the largest hindrance or the biggest challenge for myself is the self-doubt. And so as I'm quickly crawling out of that space, I'm ready to start building.
There we go. Damn, I thought you was going to go onto the mount, but it was a very concise thing. You've been thinking about this for a little while.
Yeah.
She's been building up.
I had a whole year.
Yeah, you can tell she's working because you see how specific she is with the goal. When you first start out, the goal is like everywhere. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, her answer made me think, like, damn, was I clear enough? But I'm still on that journey of figuring out what this space looks like. You see, she's been working. You know what I'm saying? She's working. I like that.
That's why I give her a hard time.
Clear and concise articulation of your goal.
That's why he follows me around.
Exactly. You know, you got to be taking some notes. He's like, all right, yo, that's all right.
I don't think that's why, but
one of these days, Tony gonna be a strong black queen one of these days.
Yo, that's what I was trying to get to.
That's what's going
on. And I, too. And you're going to address me by my proper terms, too.
I will, queen.
Latinx queen.
I'll be a Latinx queen.
Exactly.
Talk to him, queen.
At 11-11, it all came together. That's what I was looking for.
Tony is not a strong black woman.
See, Colin is an unwoke moment. He wasn't ready for it. Kyle was unwoke.
Laughing.
He was not ready for Tony to be a queen.
I embrace my divine feminine, and Kyle starts laughing at me. This is why I have problems. I gotta get a different circle.
I thought this was a safe space.
It's all over the place. Can y'all please let our listeners know how they can keep this level of conversation going, where they can find you, how they can understand all the creative ventures that y'all going down? Latasha, I'm gonna let you go first. Go ahead. Break out the stories for people.
Yes, follow my all-black streaming platform, Aurora TV, aurora.tv.com. You guys can see my web series. It is and as much as web series and short films by other Black indie creatives, I also am on YouTube on the Just Latasha channel, Just Latasha on Instagram, Just Latasha 404 on Twitter.
Hello.
Good looking Lee underscore. There's no G in looking. That's Twitter. That's Instagram and the business page, Thank Me Later Podcast NYC. That's Facebook, Instagram. There's no Twitter for the show, but we're going to see. We might have to do that.
Add that on.
And, of course, our co-host from the Thank Me Later podcast, Noelle K. You can follow me at the Noelle K. On Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, Noelle K. YouTube channel, Noelle K. Just Google Noelle K.
There we go. Just Google me.
You sound so effervescent.
Anywhere, you know?
So lovely.
There we go. It's like you're going to see a bunch of stuff pop up. Let me give you these bars again real quick. Once again, it's been another fantastic episode of Off the Strength. I'm a trainer called Tony.
K.R. Jones.
Your trainer, Corey.
Peace and much love to y'all. Until next time, we'll see you soon.